Fashion Week. My heart is ready. Yes, we are going rise for this journey. Rise in the morning and give you thanks and praise. Almighty One, my heart is ready. Yes, we are going rise for this journey. Rise in the morning and give you thanks and praise.
There you go. There you go.
Breathe, everybody.
Oh.
Breathe the breath that Yah has breathed into us.
Come on, rhythm.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father, for this time that you've given us. This time that we can tabernacle with you.
Hallelujah.
That you tabernacle within us.
Yes.
Well, we ask that we can just give you all the praise and the worship that you rightfully deserve this evening or this morning. And that you put the words in the speakers today, that we put edification of the body, that we can learn something new that will help us grow stronger in our path with you. That you are that vine that we have been grafted on, and help us bear the fruit that you have called us to bear. We ask for your anointing, your ruach, to come upon this place.
Come on.
Come upon the people's hearts.
Yes, your majesty.
Come upon all those that are dwelling on this property. To just be able to come in unity, to be in one mind, one spirit, one love, to be unified, to be bringing that power that you have given us within us, the authority that you have given us on this earth, to be that light in this darkness.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for all that you have done in our lives. We praise you in the name of Yahuwah, Yahushua, HaMashiach. Amen.
Come on.
All right, well, welcome. There's more coming. We're going to just start praising and worshiping our Father.
Yeah.
King, it's a cult celebration.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Your love and peace, your love.
Thank you. Shepherd John, the second.
Oh, yeah.
Second jump event.
Uh-huh. Blessed is the name above all names.
Oh.
Shema Yisrael. Yahweh Eloheinu. Yeah. Yes.
About that story is people that are new who those children belong to. And they would tell the mother, oh, your children are not here. And one mother said, oh, my child's here. And they didn't want to give them up. They didn't want to surrender the children to the mothers. And so the mother said, I know what I'll do. And she started to sing the Shema. And when one child starts to weep, she goes, that's my son.
Yeah.
They knew. And from there, the mother started to go across to all different places, singing the Shema.
Hallelujah.
Locating their children and reuniting the families. And our Father, one day, he'll come back. And he's going to sing the Shema. We'll cry.
Yeah.
He'll know that we belong to him.
That's right. Hallelujah. Oh. I love it.
Father, I love you so much, and the Shema means a lot to me because we hear and we do.
Mm-hmm.
He protects us, and it shows us that we belong to him.
Come on.
This is what this occult's about. We belong to one another. We are one. Right, Bernie?
Yeah.
One in him, and him in us. Mm-hmm. And that scripture is powerful.
Oh, yeah.
Father, we let them be one as we are one.
Yes. Hallelujah. That's
powerful.
That's right.
Thank the Father for his word, his Torah of truth. He has bestowed upon us. I mean, what a gift. What an honor.
Thank you.
You know, it's a very esteemed honor. And I know some people say, oh, we don't even deserve it. You know, it was a long time ago we made a choice that we would follow him. Mm-hmm. Before we were even here, he said, I knew you mm-hmm. and your mother's womb mm-hmm. before I formed you.
That's right.
Yeah. Secret there. And he formed us, and he knew us, and he gave us his Torah even before then. And as he said, we will serve you. We will do all that you say.
Yeah.
It took us a little long to get there.
Yeah. Right.
Right here.
Hallelujah! Come on. Baruch Hashem Yahuwah.
I'm going to just pray over everyone in
the
land. Thank you, Yahuwah. Thank you for every soul that you have bestowed upon this land. I ask you to bless them. As I walk around this land, Father, I ask you to bless every tree, every bush, every shrub, every fruit, every
Thank
seed.
You, Father.
Restore it to the life that you willed it. You willed that there be life in these trees, Father. Rebuke the devourer. Let there be fruit on these trees. Let them grow strong. Bring the water back, Father. We need the rains. We need the former and the latter rains.
That's right.
And it's a mystery that you say that we should have them both at the same time.
Thank you.
And I just thank you, Father. Let the overflowing of your mercy and your kindness, your chesed, your Ruach, your Rachamim, be upon this place. Let it touch every soul. Father, let the ground in these hearts be prepared for the seed that's coming forth. Let it take root, let it grow, and we have fruit to give to others. Let us hold on to one another as we go through these times. Maybe leanness. Maybe some things may come against us. But Father, we stay together as one with you. We'll make it through. I just praise you and I thank you. It's a joyous time with your Sukkot. And we celebrate the King has come.
Come on.
Yeah.
Thank you, Majesty.
So who's going first? Okay. All right, brother.
All right.
Shema!
Here, Brent.
Oh, we have two speakers. Oh. Yeah. So, two teachings. They're really awesome. Have a seat.
No, I don't want to sit. I've been sitting. Okay. I stand for a while. Brother Cook. Hey, Kirk.
I got it.
Can you move a little bit that way?
Sure.
Later on, we'll be grafting.
Yes, perfect.
Oh yeah, he's telling me. He's yeah. telling me that it just knows
it's
telling
back me. There. It's a little fuzzy because I'm so close.
Oh
yeah.
Can you see back there?
Oh yeah.
Thank you.
Is that a little better? Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Better?
Zoom in on the words.
Okay, before I actually get into the teaching, I wanted to give you a little background on myself, as well as a disclaimer about what I want to talk about. So first off, just the whole reason I wanted to even just talk about grafting, and first of all, thank you before that, thank you for the opportunity to share. But Yah is just, he just downloads things to me as I think about stuff, and maybe 8 months ago, he just said, grafting, write it down. So I write it down, and then a little bit after that, he would say, look at this, make this connection, think about this. So then I kept looking at it, and then lo and behold, I had actually something to talk about. But what's interesting is he didn't really tell me what the meaning was of these different things, and I was asking him, like, how does this go? And he's like, well, that's for you to figure out. You figure out how this all comes together, but I gave you the ingredients. And so what I really love about agriculture, grafting, that's my background. I'm a licensed landscape architect, and so I had to take botany classes, horticulture classes. I went to the School of Agriculture, so I was surrounded by that, both in study and actually the physical surroundings. And then I just love being in our garden. I love planting, and especially on Shabbat, I love going out into the garden, and that's where Abed talks to me. So often I don't really get in, and another disclaimer, I often don't get into the scriptures as deeply and as like flipping through and just diving in, digging into the word. I literally dig outside, and he speaks to me that way.
Hallelujah.
I don't want to teach on what this scripture verse, Romans 11, 16 through 24, means about who are the branches and is it the two houses, and I don't know enough about it to even get into that. What I wanted to look at is what is grafting and what's the word picture that we can see that when he says, be in me and I am in you, what does that mean? Because it's like love. You say love, what does that mean? And for me to understand scriptures, I have to be able to tangibly understand the word picture or see it out the field. If I'm digging or picking up weeds, he's teaching me about the weeds that could take over. If I'm pruning the trees, he's telling me about pinching off the buds that would force fruit on the other part. So that's kind of the gist of what I wanted to talk about. It's actually what happens when we graft, why do we graft, and what are the things that are natural and unnatural that are spoken about in the scriptures. So you can see here, just I'll read it real quick. If the root be holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches be broken off, and though, being a wild olive tree, were grafted among them, and with them partakest of the root and the fatness of the olive tree. Boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root of thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of the unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith, be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of Yah, on them which fell severity, but toward thee goodness, if thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou be cut off. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For Yah is able to graft them in again. For thou were cut off the olive tree which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? So I specifically wanted to talk about grafting, and then kind of the contrast between what the natural grafting is, what olive producers would do, versus what Yah does to us. And just by way of just the words, I chose the King James because the word graft actually isn't in there. It's a combination of things, and Sandra helped me find it from Jeff Benner.
Nice.
It's actually, the root word is kum, and it means to rot. The verb is to rot, raise, and the noun is height. And so, if you can see here, this is a picture of grafting. Grafting is always put in, and it rises up. And so, to rise or raise up, also in the sense of continuing or establishing something. So when we're grafted, we are established. And the Hebrew and Aramaic is a generic verb with a wide application, meaning to rise. It's translated 663 times in the King James Version as these different words: up, arise, raise, establish, stand, perform, confirm, again, set, establish, surely, continue, sure, abide, accomplish. And then those are the strongest numbers for the root word. So here, this is I love these old illustrations. This is what's called a cleft graft. There's all these different ways you can graft. There's probably 3 to 4 or 5 different ways people graft. But this is one of the most common ones where you actually cut across the top and you put the graft in. And I'll talk about what the different parts are in just a minute. But one thing that's very interesting is before you can graft onto a rootstock, the rootstock has to have all its limbs cut off. So it's completely emptied of itself. And then the graft, which is the shoot, has to be completely stripped. So you've got both things coming together that have both been cut and stripped.
Mm.
So let's just go over this real quick. What is grafting? Grafting is joining a scion, which is the graft. The scion,
love it.
To the stock or the root that supports it. And as I mentioned, there's numerous types of grafts, and the methods require extensive knowledge of nursery crop species and their compatibility. For example, you can't graft a grape onto an oak. They have to be compatible species. So a master gardener has to understand which species can come together to actually accept one another and bear fruit.
Yeah.
So what's interesting is, you know, Yah is our gardener. He prunes us. He cultivates. So this method of grafting is practiced by experienced master gardeners because surgical precision is required. And I'll get into the, like, what the precision actually is in just a minute. And if anybody wants this, I can email it. That is whatever you need.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Again, here's the an example of the graft where you've got basically two coming in, and you can do more, but in this scripture passage, it's talking about two branches.
Right.
So what you do is you cut the branch, then you place it in, and then you seal the wound. And I'll get into each of these parts in just a second. Mm-hmm. So, I'm sorry. Yes, exactly.
What'd you say?
It's about this two becoming one.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and we're gonna get into actually the cellular dynamics of what's happening. Yeah. When I read the scriptures, almost everything I see is our culture. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Cool.
Beautiful. That's what they did. So I'm specifically talking about the olive. Why the olive? Grafting is done in the olive oil industry, which actually dates back. They found seeds of olives that were cultivated in Spain 8,000 years ago. It's the idea is you get the hardy roots of one variety with the fruitfulness or productivity of another variety.
Mm.
That's why you're putting the two together, because you're not getting what you want out of just one.
Mm.
And the whole point of grafting is that the grafted tree, now this is the natural, we'll get into the unnatural part. This is the natural part. So if you're, you know, if we go out to the field and we did this is why we do this. The whole point is that you want the grafted tree, the branch, to keep its original character, because that's what you want. You want that fruit. And the root, which is almost 99.9% of the time is wild, is chosen because it's not susceptible to disease, fungus, or other pests, but itself doesn't really produce a lot of fruit, but the roots are extremely strong. So you have this amazing rootstock that's wild, and you need to get a cultivated olive to bring in the fruit. So the graft, which is the good, may have weak roots, but large fruit and high oil content. So then the good branch would then be producing fruit and getting nourishment from the wild root. And several branches will be grafted onto one tree. And then the scripture verse came to my mind about the roots not susceptible to disease. Torah says that we will not have disease if we obey the commandments.
Come on.
Hiding in our root.
Mm. Mm,
nice.
So quickly, yeah. This is what is considered natural. You want the fruit, and you put it on the rootstock, and the rootstock is the point of the rootstock is just to support what the fruit is. So in nature, you can have what's called the fruit salad tree, where you can take 5 to 7 different fruits. These are called stone fruits because they're a similar species, and you can actually graft them all into one tree. Now this image is actually photoshopped, but the images that I wanted to find all had like a watermark on them. But this actually exists. I have friends that own these, or you know, have these in their yard.
Wow.
You can actually go and pick an apricot. You can go get a peach, a plum, an apple, all off the same tree. And then they've recently come up with this one on the right called ketchup and fries, where they've actually grafted tomatoes onto potatoes. So
wow.
You get ketchup and fries. And this actually took 15 years for them to figure out how to actually get it to be like that. So, just interesting things.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'll go to the wild part, and this is from Brad Scott. But here's a great example of a wild tree. So obviously, to survive in a condition like that, you're going to have some pretty strong roots. But you can see it's not bearing. It doesn't have a big structure, so it's not going to bear much fruit.
Right.
But per Brad, the word wild is taken from the Greek word agrios, which is where we get agriculture. There's basically two Hebrew words translated into our word wild as appears in our text. The first word, sade, is used quite frequently and is the common Hebrew word for a field. It's first used in Genesis 2:5, and every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for Yahweh Elohim had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground, for there was nothing to cultivate it. It's a word used to speak of vegetation that is not in a garden and growing out wild in the field, so it's not within the gates. The other word used in the Hebrew text, which we get the word, is peri. This word means to be unconstrained or free from control. It's translated as wild, divided, separated, and scattered. This word most closely resembles the way our dominant religion looks at their newfound freedom in Messiah. I'm free. I can be wild. I don't have to be contained by anything. But this is a description of what we were before we came into the kingdom of Yah. So again, wild olive, strong roots, but little fruit. So how does the graft take place? So in order to get this picture on the bottom, first the scion or the graft has to be selected. So you want to hand pick what you're going to actually graft in. But it has to be cut off. And this is another thing that Abba just showed me, is it's severed from its life source. So it had life, it has all this fruit, and it's cut off. So it no longer has any sustenance, it has no roots. Now you can manipulate it, you can stick it in rooting hormone, but if you just left it by its own, it would die.
Yeah.
So I would just like to suggest that grafting could be a picture of being born again.
Yeah. Right.
Because the scion must unite with a new rootstock.
Yeah.
So we die to ourselves and become like Messiah, being born of the Spirit with a change of status and character. We have a new nature similar to the grafted branch. So I just have a couple of scriptures here. We are dead to sin but alive in Yeshua. Therefore, if anyone's in Messiah, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. And then in Galatians, I am crucified with Yeshua. It is no longer I who live, but it is Yeshua who lives in me.
So come on.
I'll talk a little bit about what it means to be in.
Mm.
So this is what's really cool.
Oh, wow.
So in order to create the graft, there has to be a vertical cut made through the bark, or the outer wall, into the cambium, which is the layer that actually has all the nutritional value that actually the exchange takes place. So this vascular cambium, and it's vascular because it's acting like our arteries and veins. It's pumping sap. The xylem goes high and the phloem goes low, so it's going up and down like our arteries and veins. And in order for the graft to actually unite with the rootstock, the two cambiums must be aligned in order for them to accept each other. But that was very interesting. You can't just stick it in there and hope for the best. It has to be precisely lined up so that there's an exchange that takes place. So the cambium is the place of connection where cell exchange takes place. And just another little download, I'm not sure if this is actually, I have a disclaimer, I can't support this scripturally, but this is just what Abba showed me. There's an outer and an inner bark, and a sapwood and a heartwood, and interesting, like a tabernacle, you come through,
oh, wow,
come through until you get to the inside, which is the heart, the nourishment, where everything comes from.
Hallelujah.
It's interesting, the phloem is on the outside. So again, it's just down here. I need to go sometimes. So what's interesting is it reminds me that you have to. And if you can't graft horizontally. It doesn't work. Because if you stick something in a tree horizontally, it's going to fall off. So it has to be incised vertically, which again reminded me of the veil being torn vertically.
Wow, that's skin. Super cool. Wow.
So,
yeah.
So the graft is given direct access to the blood, which is the xylem and the phloem, or the sap. The xylem and the phloem transport fluid and nutrients within the plant's tissues like the blood vessels in our body. And then it reminded me of life is in the blood.
Yeah.
So we have to connect to the source of life in order to actually get the nutrition and to actually survive. So here's just the different layers. So this is that cambium layer right here, where you have to cut into that in order for the two pieces to come and actually allow for exchange to take place. Mm.
Question?
Sure.
Actually, a comment. What's interesting is the Mashiach was impaled on the Staros, which was the pole. He was attached to the Xylos. Mm. And from the Xylos attached to the Staros. So it's just interesting, the Xylom is access to the blood. He was attached to the Xylos and then put on the pole.
Wow. That's deep.
Thanks for sharing
that. Yeah. Good job, brother. Good job.
If you cut too deep, does it mess up the grafting process?
Yes, you actually can't. You can't cut through. You can't cut through the sapwood into here. Otherwise, you damage the heart.
Right.
You can only cut this part to get to this part. And that what happens is then the tree opens up and allows for exchange to take place.
Mm.
So I know there's some things I've heard about grafting in 3 days, and I looked it up, and I don't have anything to support that, because basically in order for the graft to be successful, you don't even know what's happening on the inside until something happens on the outside.
Hmm.
Wow.
So first off, in order to beautiful. Have a graft successfully take place, the cut. Where you graft it in, that has to heal or crust over. So sometimes people will put clay over the incision. They'll put other things to form that bond so that nothing can get in there and cause mm-hmm. infection or disease. So the graft site has to put its guard up in order to protect the inner parts where we or it is or are connected to the source. So it's interesting in Proverbs, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that we have to have that protection against infection. So what's happening inside, and this is from a website I found that really was just talking about genetic transfer. So grafted tissues fuse and establish this vascular connection. It's the connection between the xylem and the phloem. Grafted, whether natural or assisted, provides a path for horizontal gene transfer. So there's an exchange of DNA that's taking place. So the graft is coming in, and the DNA is crossing through that cambium, and then you've got this transfer of identity. So according to this Stegeman and Bach analysis, indicates that large DNA pieces or even entire plastid genomes, and that's the whole like mitochondria of a cell, can go right through to the other side.
Wow.
Mm.
So the sap will flow through this union point from the stalk into the scion. So there's an exchange that takes place, but it doesn't take place from out in, it takes place from in out. So the DNA transfer actually is from the root to the graft.
Wow.
While the primary meristem, which is, I can get into some of this in more technical terms, helps the plant grow upwards, the secondary meristem, which is the vascular cambium, actually helps the plant grow upwards, which is like the word we talked about. The vascular cambium lets the plant expand in girth, and ultimately forms the protective layers of plant fibers in their stems necessary for growth and development. So without this, we can't expand, we can't grow, we can't grow up.
Okay.
The vascular cambium produces several important secondary components, which is the xylem and the phloem.
I just thought of is the creation of a baby.
Same oh, thing. Yeah. Absolutely.
Going into the womb, the seed is planted, and it begins.
Yeah.
So I just kind of thought of that when you were
the
saying that.
The umbilical cord, the transfer.
The cord.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, that's good. So on the bottom here, we've got kind of a young graft where the branches have been cut off and they've been grafted in. On the far right, the picture actually said it was from the Garden of Gethsemane, where they're actually grafting onto these 1,000-year-old rootstocks.
Wow.
So after you've actually seen that there is growth, in order to produce the fruit, you have to prune. And oftentimes when you see all this pruned, it looks like they just got hammered. Again, there was this amazing picture of this olive tree that was completely pruned back really, really hard and just surrounded by all these branches, almost like people were just, like, this reminded me of worshiping at the throne. Again, it had a huge watermark across it, so I didn't want to use it. But this one, you can tell it's been cut back pretty hard. And there's lots of reasons for it. If you don't prune it back, then you don't get the yield of the fruit. Mm. There's just too much branch and too many little fruits, and they won't become large.
So right.
Cut it back so that actually it gives as much energy to the fruits as possible, so you get a bigger yield. So actually by pruning, you get more. Mm-hmm. The other thing too is you need to get, olive trees can get so dense that the light won't get in there to actually get to the leaves, and we need the light to create the glory. So proper pruning is important for the olive. Oh, go back real quick. I am the vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit prunes so it'll be even more fruitful. So pruning regulates the production, and it actually shapes the tree. So a lot of times, with these really old trees, they can actually shoot up a lot, but then it's really hard to get to the fruit. So in order for the gardener to actually pick the fruit, they prune it so it's easier to get to the fruit. Mm. The olive tree can withstand radical pruning. Actually, it can even withstand fire. And you can actually cut it to the ground. And I saw all over different botanical websites that there's the term, you can hardly kill an olive tree because the roots are so deep. Even with a fire can rip through it, and a year later it's blooming up strong.
Mm. Wow.
Because the roots are so deep and so strong.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
The other thing is, there's a thing called alternate bearing, which means that you'll have a really strong harvest one year, and the next harvest not so much. So if you want to make sure that every year is somewhat consistent, and you want to get as much yield as you can, you have to prune, otherwise it's really unpredictable what you're going to get next season. And we have an avocado tree in our backyard, and every other year it gives a lot and then a little, because I don't hack it back. It's interesting that the olive never bears fruit in the same place twice. And what I think is interesting, it bears fruit on the previous year's growth. So in order to bear fruit, that pruning site from last year has been growing, and then the fruit produce is there.
Yeah.
Not what you've just pruned.
That's cool.
And it also removes damaged or diseased branches.
Hmm.
This is a picture in Greece, over 1,000-year-old olive tree that's still producing. I forget the name, but they call it basically the Millennium Olive. And it just reminded me of, like, just how amazing these olive trees are.
Yeah.
Yeshua said, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. This is my Father's joy, that you bear much fruit. Show yourselves to be my disciples. So once we're connected to the vine, we will bear much fruit for the kingdom, because the life of the vine provides that for us.
Mm.
When we live taking life from the very essence of Yah within us, then what's produced in our lives comes from that union. We can do nothing on our own. Like, you can have a piece of a graft, and it does nothing by itself. It's why it's necessary to remain united to the vine, which is drawing life. So a little bit about the fruit. On the upper left here, we've got wild olives in the man's palm on the top. Mm. You've got the cultivated olives on the bottom. So you can see the substantial difference between getting something that's been cultivated versus getting what's wild. You're not going to get much of anything out of that from the top.
So per ratio from the wild to the cultivated, are the seeds much smaller in the wild also? Or are the seeds larger. Just almost as large, but a lot less meat? Like, how does that work on that?
Actually, the seeds, and we'll get into this, we're going to talk about genetics and seeds, but actually it's not about the seed, it's about the oil.
Mm.
So basically on the top, you have a seed that's just wrapped in a casing. And at the bottom, you've got that same size seed completely wrapped in oil.
Wow. Okay.
They're about this, I mean, they're almost identically the same size. But actually, cultivating olives, you don't use the seeds. In fact, for any fruit trees, the seeds aren't used, and I'll explain why it's really interesting. But you also, there's no such thing as a green olive tree and a black olive tree. They're both from the same tree.
Mm.
So a green olive is actually immature fruit that hasn't been on the tree long enough to fully ripen. Mm. And just some characteristics, it's firm, it's bitter, the oil is difficult to extract, and you get a very low yield of actually what you're looking for.
Huh.
But if you let it sit on the tree and let it mature until it ripens to this kind of beautiful bluish black, it's very soft, the oil is sweet, it's easy to extract, and you get an extremely high yield of oil.
Mm.
And then just a couple interesting facts just about the oil. Olive oil is 99% pure fuel. It does not produce smoke or soot. It does not burn until it reaches 550 degrees. So it has a really low volatility due to its high flash point, so it's not flammable. It also has a really low oxidation level, which means all the things on the perimeter that could possibly taint it, it's incredibly difficult to taint olive oil because it's so stable.
Nice.
Pretty darn interesting. Oh, and when it's burned, it creates a very sweet scent. Mm-hmm. And so I believe that the scriptures, when it talks about the lamps and the oil, that they're burning olive oil.
Yeah.
And then I'm not supporting the WHO, but it's interesting that the World Health Organization specifically suggests that olive oil is the healthiest source of fat on the planet.
Huh.
And it has no trans fatty acids, so you can drink as much of it as you want. You can drink it for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Yeah.
All it's going to do is do good for you. In fact, I think David Letterman, after he had quite a bypass, his doctors told him, morning, noon, and night, you need to drink 8 ounces of olive oil, and your life will be spared.
Wow.
Just another little tidbit, and I don't want to get too much into the sexuality of flowers and things like that, but it's interesting, on most fruit trees, flowers are called perfect because they have both male and female parts, and the pollen is spread by the wind, or the ruach.
Wow.
Mono means one, and eshes means house, so monoecious plant species, this perfect flower, has both sexes in one house, or an individual.
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it was one. Yeah.
Be perfect.
Right, they were perfect. And then there are other means of the flowers being pollinated, but this is the majority of the way that the plants actually bear fruit. It's pretty cool. So just a little bit about seeds versus grafting. So obviously, we just talked about grafting, getting the high yield, and you're pruning it to get as much as you can from that olive. But with seeds are not used for fruit trees because the seed keeps a record of all generations that came from.
Mm.
So when we're grafted in and we're cut off from our old life, that's gone.
Yeah.
But if you plant a seed, that entire genetic history is still there.
Oh.
So you don't know what you're going to get. You can't be sure of the fruit. In grafting, you get exactly what you want. I couldn't remember the source of this part that's highlighted in kind of beige, so I just kind of put a color there. I lost the source, so I'll just whoever
they said.
I want to give them a. The cross-pollination is sexual reproduction for trees, so that's obviously how they reproduce, they have to be pollinated. Even if a fruit tree variety is considered to be self-pollinating, that perfect flower, it's still receptive of other pollen. And the seeds of the fruit end up with the history from past generations of both parent trees. So oftentimes, when you want to get two species to crossbreed or hybridize, you'll plant an orange tree, you'll have a Valencia, you'll have a navel, and the navel and the Valencia are going to cross-pollinate each other, so you're starting to get characteristics of both ending up in the seed. So in order to keep it pure, you have to keep grafting, otherwise you lose the purity of the gene. The fruit's merely a vessel for the seed. Seeds are what carry a history of traits from the parent tree and its pollinating partners. There's a lot of potential, because you've got this long history, so there's a lot of potential. Like, wow, you don't know what you're going to get. This could be amazing.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So okay, so you get a fruit that's grafted on from a graft.
Right.
So does the fruit have a seed in it?
It does.
And then would that seed have the generations passed from the other, or?
From anything that came in contact with the flower to pollinate it.
Oh, okay.
Before that.
Not from the scion itself, but from whatever comes from the
From the
flower that's produced by the scion and
exactly.
The other flower.
Right.
The pollination.
So it's not the first generation.
but not from the scion itself. Not the graft. The
graft itself doesn't have the seed. It's the seed
that's
involved in the fruit.
Wow.
Yeah.
So are you basically saying that the seed can go all the way back to Genesis from the very beginning and have all of that history?
Yeah.
that has the entire genetic history of as long as it can go
back. Just like us.
Wow.
In the beginning.
So that's why we got to be made new.
Just like us.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So I'm getting a little confused now by the question. I think you said a few steps back when you take the graft and put it in, the scion is the root. Is that correct?
No, the scion is the graft.
Scion is the graft.
Branch.
If you take the graft, the scion, and graft it into the rootstock.
Right.
And you said there was an exchange of DNA, but it's not from the outside in, it's from the inside out.
It's from the rootstock to the scion.
Oh, so wow. The seed is going to have that rootstock.
It's going to be produced in that flower that's going to become a fruit on the branch.
Right.
Is getting its DNA from the root. But
yes.
Also from pollination from
right.
Cross. Okay.
So when you get that pollination, you're getting all the different characteristics from anything else that it was touched by before.
And the root as well.
And the root.
Well, that's really cool.
Right.
So that's why they have orange groves. So that they just pollinate just pure orange.
They do, but those groves are actually like, for example, if you wanted to go and get a Braeburn apple, and you say, okay, I'm going to take this apple seed, like you said, so throw me out, it's okay, I promise. if you go and you take that and you say, this was the most amazing apple I've ever had, about the farmer's market, it's organic. It's GMO, or it's non-GMO, it's been just loved and prayed over, I'm going to take that seed, and I want that fruit. You're not going to get that fruit ever again.
Mm.
You're going to get something else. So in order to keep getting that fruit, you have to keep grafting off the tree that gave that fruit.
Ah, okay. Well, then that's good, because I lost the seed that I really wanted.
So at the bottom, when you buy another tree that's called Gala or Fuji or Bartlett pear, they're actually clones of the one and only original that has that name in order to keep that consistently every single time. Wow. Otherwise, you get a Gala that's part, you know, part this, part that.
Hmm.
You'd get a Bartlett pear that's something else.
Hmm.
So in order to keep it pure, you continually have to graft from the original plant, the original tree. So these orange groves are hybridized. They're not hybridized. I mean, they are pollinated, but you're not taking those seeds and then planting them. You're continually grafting. So if there's a tree that has fruit that you don't like, then you just cut it out. But if you're like, oh, man,
fire.
This grove over here is amazing. The east side, they'll cut all those branches off and they'll graft them on a stock.
Right.
And that's also a grafting. You can graft an amazing fruit variety and stick it on a trunk, and the trunk will actually create it as a dwarf. So if you want this amazing fruit, but the tree grows 40 feet tall and you want it to be 20 feet tall, you put it on a rootstock that's a dwarf. And that root will then cause this new Zion to be a dwarf.
Absolutely.
Not the fruit, but the tree itself.
Yeah.
So there's all this different stuff you can do to kind of get what you want, to get that fruit that you're really looking for.
Yeah. So then it is okay to do all the different mixtures of the fruits. Is that okay? Versus, I know the scripture talks about mixing the seed, like you're not supposed to mix it, so that's something totally contrasts to grafting.
Right. I wouldn't, the whole idea of the fruit salad tree and the ketchup and fries thing, I'm not saying that's a good idea. I think that's what nature says to do, but Abba's word says we're grafted unnaturally, contrary to nature. So we don't want to have our fruit anymore. We want His fruit.
Hallelujah.
We don't want to be. I mean, although we're all parts, of like the idea of like we're all members. And I was trying to think about how this analogy works with, well, what if I'm a hand and John's a foot and Rachel's the knee, and like how does that work with grafting? It's You can't have all these different fruits on one tree. That's not natural. It's not natural to do that. You have to graft it like that. But then each of those different fruits keeps its identity.
Hmm.
Otherwise, you wouldn't have. For example, if you had a fruit salad tree, and then the next year you go out there and you're like, wow, they're all apples this year. That would never happen. This branch will always have pears. This branch will always have almonds. This pear will always have apples.
Wow.
In order for us to be in Messiah and be His body, we need to have His DNA in us.
Come on.
Say, you're me. You're an offshoot of me, but your DNA is coming from the root. You're not staying as a pear. You're
beautiful.
Yeah,
who's joining you for sure?
Yeah, that's really cool. I think that's all I have. Yeah, that's all I have.
No way.
Can you
question?
No way.
Yes.
How many apple seeds can you eat before you hurt yourself with cyanide poison?
Oh my gosh.
50, a jubilee.
they're poisonous, right? I mean, in a small scale, aren't
well,
they?
Well, most seeds are coated with a cyanide.
Not just apple seeds.
Not just apple seeds. A lot of plants that grow. And this is one of my kind of pet peeves in my industry is there's all these beautiful hedges that people plant by schools and parks, and the seeds and the fruit are coated with cyanide. And when you ingest that cyanide, if you're a small animal or a small child, it's actually a pretty high concentration and it can kill somebody. But in a small seed, for an adult, I mean, you probably have to sit down and eat a lot on an empty stomach, and you probably start feeling it.
Yeah,
that's their way of protecting themselves.
What is a cyanide?
Cyanide is actually a chemical. And I forget the actual term for it. But there's two things come together, and the interesting thing too is once it's ingested and our stomach acid hits that, it actually changes the whatever it was before, I forget the term, to a stronger version of cyanide.
Oh. Wow.
So by itself, you leave it alone, it'll be protected from the elements, but within us, if you start digesting it, it actually changes it to be actually more chemically reactive. Mm.
Well, it's good for you to eat a little bit.
Yeah, I some.
I'm good. Take a minute.
That's what's wrong with you.
Sir, we ought to
eat
the seeds.
You asked
for that
one.
Right? Did
you take
the seeds
out
just a minute?
Say sorry.
Or is it a little strychnine? Don't hurt anybody.
Maybe
still here. Well, the thing with fruit trees is their coating is pretty minimal. The amount of cyanide. I mean, if you looked at... There's trees that they'll say if a horse comes up and eats the berries of a tree, you can actually kill a horse.
Yeah.
Those are really high concentrations. Like there's a wild cherry, Prunus alisifolia, and those berries have so much cyanide in it, you can kill a horse. So obviously we're not going around and juicing those, but fruits of like apples and oranges and pears. It's so minute that you hardly ever know.
Right.
And it's being blended in with everything else.
Well, you're saying this about the cherry. There is like a bush that grows like little red cherries. You
that's
know
the
those?
One.
Mm-hmm. That's the one?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I actually had a client one time. I was walking his property and I said, do you know about this Prunus? And he said, no. I said, well, the berries are extremely dangerous. These have a really high concentration of cyanide. And his jaw dropped, and he's like, my children make pies with this. And I said, would you like me to take them out?
Like
he's like,
crazy.
Just give me an invoice and take care of it. So, switch them out.
Nah.
Can organic food have cyanide in it?
Well, again, it's a very, very, very small amount. It's a trace amount in like an apple or a pear or an orange. But out in the wild, the ones that aren't cultivated, those have a really high concentration. And the only reason they know that it killed the horse is because you have a horse dead and they open up its stomach and it's full of berries.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Right.
Just like how our forefathers learned what mushrooms to pick and what to eat. They got really sick on that one and just everyone lived.
Right, right.
Yeah.
That was good.
Mushrooms kosher then?
Yeah. I don't know. I think
shrooms?
So. Mushrooms. Reishi, shiitake, I mean, they're really cool.
Yeah.
Well, I like those.
Yeah, if you got
arthritis,
they're
complicated. Yeah, yeah.
Go ahead and quit eating them.
There's really only about 3 or 4 wild hedges that actually have that fruit that can kill like a donkey or a horse or a small child.
Right.
So, yeah. I would feed Joseph many opposites that wanted to create him. And in fact, what's interesting is there's trace amounts of almost everything in our food.
Yeah.
Just picking it up from the ground. So even if you said, oh, this is the most pure, organic, non-GMO farm over here, there's still stuff in the air, gets into the water, gets into the soil. Why
does
the fruit have traces of this?
Right. So you're saying that...
It's not in a dome. Robert first.
Yep.
Oh.
This is terribly interesting. I'm more or less blown away and it's really great.
But yeah.
I was wondering if you have any commentary on the scripture revelation that talks about the tree of life bearing 12 fruit.
I think that's talking about 12 tribes.
12 tribes.
Yeah.
And I haven't studied this scripture enough deeply to understand who's cut off, who's grafted in. I know there's different camps. You know, the Christian church says, well, what, you know, we're grafted in now, and, you know,
we're
all that
Christians.
Old stuff is it's like, well, if you're grafted into the Torah, then why would God get rid of those who are in the Torah?
Right.
So there's all these different camps and different things that I didn't have enough time or I didn't want to get into that about what
right.
the two branches mean, and is it the two houses, is it Jews and Gentiles, or, you know, what? Maybe I can do that next to COVID.
Yeah!
Yeah.
Yeah,
you're to figure it out.
What time is it?
I'm going to
get a new watch.
Right. Okay, 10.
Oh, real quick, I just want to say, as you're talking, I'm seeing myself standing at the kitchen sink looking, you know, at the window, and I have little seeds that I've saved from different
yes.
Ah, cool.
And I'll ask him every now and again, can I plant this and get a tree? He's like, yeah, you'll get a tree, but. And so now I'm like, okay, every time I have this desire to want to plant
your
my
salaries.
Tree,
yeah.
Now I'm going to remember, but this is awesome because now I can remember that, you know, I don't want whatever fruit. I want Yah's fruit in me.
Come on.
Like, oh my gosh, all the applications to our own life,
and
this little thing is just
mind-boggling. What's really cool is I think it was in college, we took a tour with a guy that was really connected to the horticulture department, and he showed us grafting, and it was amazing. He would just walk up to a tree, and he's like, I really like this one, I'm going to graft this one today. And he would just take out a Swiss Army knife and just cut it off. And then he would come up to the other tree and go, and the amount of incision that he made on both was absolutely perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And he would put them together, and I turned, I'm like, that's incredible. And our professor's like, he's been doing this for 40 years.
Right.
Wow.
Every single incision he does is right on. He doesn't
surgeon.
Mess. He doesn't
he's
make a mistake.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so that's, I mean, Yah does it perfectly.
Yeah, amazing.
Sadie, I
okay.
think seven.
Okay, how about the date palm? And do you know anything about the dates and figs? And
love
figs, because figs is full of seeds.
Yes, yes.
So,
yeah.
Eat the seeds, is that a lot of script?
Oh, they're good for you, those seeds.
You can eat that stuff.
Those don't have
the coating.
Yeah, I don't think. I mean.
And what's interesting about date trees, you know, we use them a lot to frame entrances to, you know, buildings, things like that.
Yeah, right.
The taller they are, the cheaper they are. Why do you think it's been growing longer? It should be more expensive. After 18 feet, all the palms in the palm desert, they're like, that's too tall. We can't use ladders anymore.
Hmm.
So we have to get equipment out there, and the equipment like runs over the roots. So the taller the tree, it's not worth it to us anymore. So they sell those for commercial activities. And the trees that are between like 12 and 16 feet, they can just prop a ladder up and grab the fruits.
Right.
That's what they want. So it's, again, it's kind of the idea of keeping it low so you can grab the fruit you need. It doesn't take you too much to get what you want.
Yeah, because Salton Sea has where all the date palms are. They grow them there, and you can go and buy them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
so now I know I'm going to graft my nephew has a really good fig tree. So if I bought a fig tree and then took the grafting from his and put it onto the new fig tree, I'd get from that branch the same fig.
Right. Or if you bought a fig tree, that itself is grafted.
Yeah.
If it tells you it's a, I don't know all the varieties of figs, but let's say it's a fig type 1. That fig type 1 has been grafted from type 1 fruit to a certain stock. And for, I wish I took a picture of it, but we have this amazing tangerine tree in our yard. And most citrus, like limes, lemons, oranges, they're actually grafted onto the rootstock of nuts, like an almond tree or a walnut.
Mm.
Because the walnuts and the almonds are so strong,
right.
The citrus roots aren't very good. So they graft it in, and we have this amazing root that comes up, and you can see the thing is just grafted right into it. It's really cool. But yeah, most fruit trees, they're all grafted, but they're grafted into the roots of nut trees. Mm. So it'll be interesting when we go out to the pistachios just to kind of look on the ground and see how sturdy those are.
Oh, wow.
Yes, Emma?
Does the coconut have seeds? I've never seen seeds on coconut.
The coconut itself doesn't.
The coconut is a seed.
It is a seed.
If a coconut drops, I used to live in Hawaii, and coconuts would drop on the ground and just lay there, and new trees
come out
of the coconut itself.
Yeah. I saw that.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
It is a seed.
Yeah.
Can we grow a coconut tree here?
In this environment,
but you need the heat for it to produce the fruits and stuff.
Yeah, we're not tropical enough.
Yeah.
Too dry.
Too dry.
Moisture.
I just wanted to say, towards the beginning when you talked about the process, the act of grafting, and how the main tree has to be cut. I think you had all the branches had to be cut off.
That one, that was cool.
You showed a picture, but you said that the root tree had to be, all the branches had to be cut off,
right.
And then the graft has to be stripped.
Right.
And it just reminded me of how Yeshua just poured himself out.
Yeah.
And not only that, and then we're stripped. I mean, we usually have to come to the end of ourselves and everything is gone before we are ready to say yes, and he can, graft us in. But it made me also think of natural Israel, and I mean, how many thousands of millions of them were cut off because they didn't have faith, and if they had been cut off, we couldn't have been grafted in. I think Paul talks about
that's
that.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
That's a really good point.
It's like so many people shake the finger at these Jews that, they're unbelief, but if they hadn't,
right.
they rejected Mashiach,
it's all part of Yah's plan.
Wouldn't be able to come in. So, I mean, it's just amazing, all these things that have to take place in order for us
right.
to have life, and just everything
right.
that he did for
come
us.
On. Thank
and
you,
then, it's, the natural branches are going to be able to come back in. And they have already.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hallelujah, we're here.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And,
wow.
And the other thing that I didn't include in here, but just like what you were saying, Sandra, is the scripture says a shoot will come out of the root of Jesse.
Yeah.
So how does the shoot come out? Well, it has to be cut down to the root first.
Oh, cool.
Hallelujah. Oh, that's something.
Well, as you're teaching all this, I see everything in the spirit. So when you said cut down, like we need to be cut down constantly. And the scripture, this is my personal prayer every day, John 15:5. I am the vine, we are the branches. It does say, if you remain in me and I in you. Can you go to the picture where it shows the wild?
Oh, sure, this one?
No.
Oh, the fruit?
The fruit. Let me see.
That one?
Yes. I love that. When you showed that, let me just bring it up here. The wild. Cultivated the first picture with the hemp, the little seeds,
the little ones on the top, yeah, those ones.
Okay, and then
wow.
the bigger ones fully flourish. Now, this is what happens to us, and this is why I pray this every day. That he is a vine, I'm a branch, but I need to be cut down from me. I need to be weeded out. And pruned from me. This is about dying to the flesh for me. And so if I don't do that and abide in him and stay in him, this is what happens to us. The green part, the middle, it says when we don't do this, spiritually speaking, we become firm. We become like Pharaoh.
Hard-hearted.
And we become bitter, like it says, bitter oil.
Mm.
And then it says oil is difficult to extract.
Right.
We have none. Just
yeah.
like the ten
all
virgins.
Flesh.
Just like the ten virgins. Five were ready, five were not.
Yeah, they didn't have enough oil.
Mm-hmm. Because obviously they weren't dying to their flesh.
Mm.
They were too worried about other things and their concerns and their life.
Yeah.
And low yield, we can't produce much, spiritually speaking, out here. But if we abide in Him and stay in Him and die daily to this flesh, then we can become tender-hearted. We can become tender-hearted like Yeshua. We don't hear that too much. We hear about the fruits of the Spirit. But one of His greatest attributes, of course, for me is number one, is humility. Mm-hmm. He humbles Himself all the way to the execution stage.
Amen.
Right?
Amen, sister.
But,
so, said well.
But, so I was just getting so much from this one picture right here, and how we can become, if we don't abide in Him and stay in Him, become like the middle picture.
Yeah.
We're not bearing, nothing's happening with us at all. Spiritually speaking, we cannot pour into anybody's life. How can we? But if we stay and abide in Him, this is will look like that beautiful, for me it looks purple, I love purple.
Yeah.
It looks purple blue,
yeah.
And that's royalty. The dark blue is for divinity.
Mm-hmm.
And all these things were just coming through my mind as you were on that one particular picture. And so if we stay in Him and abide in Him, then we will produce much.
Come on.
Hallelujah. Was he
going to
say something?
Oh, Johnny.
I was just saying, I was thinking the root that was that spread out of Jesse, right? Okay, that's Yahushua who was cut down for us, and then now we get engrafted to Him, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and now, and then, yeah, when we get engrafted to Him, then we begin to prune our flesh to produce the fruit, because you know we got fruit of Him who we are attached to.
Right. The other cool thing about, about pruning, the other idea of kind of keeping everything closest to the tree, is that the fruit that's far off, that's going to get the nutrients last.
Oh, wow,
so
that's
the fruit
beautiful.
That's closest to the vine is the thickest and juiciest.
I like that.
So we're always trying to pinch off the ends to force
the
nutrients to the ones that are closest.
Very, very good.
Yeah. All right. I'm sure you guys are almost done. So I was thinking when you were speaking with regard to the Zeons being grafted into the tree, I was my heart was understanding that we experience that every time we come and assemble. Because the root source is the Torah. And that's the vitality of life. And we're all different individuals that are branched and coming together. We still keep our identity, but the unity that brings us together is the Messiah, is
come on.
The Word of Yahweh.
Yes.
I thought that was
kind of common. Yeah.
So yeah, I find it interesting because you said that we normally in nature we would get the cultivated branch and put it on the wild tree.
Right.
But what has happened in Scripture is where the wild branch is put on the,
on
the cultivated root.
Beautiful.
And the opposite, so it's like a flip around, you know?
Yeah. Unnatural.
Everything's contrary to
that. Instead of us producing our own fruit, which would be the way that it should happen in our nature, it's like we're doing the Henley things, right?
Yeah, turn it upside down.
Yeah, exactly. When we fell, the whole spirit turned upside down. The spirit was the last thing and the flesh was the first thing. But now that we've been born again, born from above, it's back upside right.
Upside right.
There it is.
Yeah.
So that was cool.
Love it.
Great question.